Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Assailants, Asphalt, and Alibis by Tonya Kappes, narrated by Johanna Parker. 1. The silence from at least 100 people was almost as deafening as the bullfrogs billowing around the Happy Trails Campground lake, while one of the treasure hunters told the group about the regional legend of John Swift's silver mine. The flicker of the red, yellow, and orange flames showed in all their eyes as they focused on the intriguing story of the possibility that in and around my campground could be a massive amount of silver just waiting to be claimed. In the year 1760, John Swift made his way into Kentucky from the Gap and followed the creek known now as Swift's Creek. He was a well-educated Englishman that was a natural-born leader and sailor of his own ships off the coast of the Carolinas. It was when he'd come to Kentucky when he met up with a man by the name of Montgomery. Swift wasn't happy with the British and let it be known. It was then he and Montgomery had begun to counterfeit the British crown as a way of getting back at the British for invading the land we are gathered upon today, as well as the entire Daniel Boone National Forest. Mason Kavanaugh's voice held a mysterious tone that rose up and down with the importance of what he had to say. He held up a piece of paper that appeared to be the journal he'd mentioned. Swift had heard of the mines in Kentucky, and maybe a mention or two about there being silver here. Thus began his several mining expeditions to Kentucky. Mason leaned over his knees and swept his hands in front of him. His eyes grew big. The flames of the fire made his blue eyes sparkle to life, making the scene ominous. It wasn't until a wounded bear led a very courageous Swift to a rock house, which is what we call a cave. This was the first time Swift found silver. It wasn't the only rock house or cave where Swift found silver. He noted all of the places in his journal, including maps. He held up more papers with upside-down V designs and big X's scribbled all over them. He brought the paper up to his eyes and leaned into the glow of the campfire. He read, "Taken directly from John Swift's journal." Then he continued, "7 miles above the mouth of the creek is a natural rock bridge. On the northwest side of the creek, a short distance below the bridge, is a branch. Follow the branch to its head, thence ascend the ridge, leaving the highest part of the ridge on your right. Go along the ridge to a point that is higher than the others, where a large rock seems to have fallen from above. Go in between them. This is where we obtained our best ore." He pulled the papers down from his face and sat back, turning his head from side to side, as if he were trying to see what others thought about his tale. His stare stopped on another camper. I watched as her brow rose and didn't break the eye contact. He looked back down at his papers as if he were trying to compose himself. "The creek he refers to, we believe, is what we know now as Swift Creek, located right here in Normal." He looked up, and a slow grin crossed his face. The flicker of the fire caught his eyes at the right moment, making shadows cross his face. Goosebumps crawled along my legs.
"Don't tell me you're falling for this crap."
Dottie Swaggart flicked the ash off her lit cigarette and brought it to her mouth, taking a long draw. Her red hair lay in curls around her head.
"Because if you do, I've got a gold mine right under my old camper over there. I'll let you have it for $100.
The smoke rolled out of her mouth, and she pointed to her camper at the front of the campground. A few people turned around to shush her. She gave them the death stare with big eyes.
"All these people are fools."
She took one last puff before she threw it on the ground and snuffed it out with the toe of her flip-flop. Dottie stormed off toward her camper. She'd had enough.
"Not all of those journeys were successful. Swift and his crew were met with numerous obstacles, from Indian attacks to mutiny among his crew, which was when John Swift holed up in one of his silver mines and finished his journals. He even had time to fall in love with the widow Renfro before he was deported back to England, where he was convicted of counterfeiting the crowns. It's rumored he left his journals and treasure map with the widow Renfro until he joined her after he'd served his sentence. Mason's eyes shifted back and forth. Unfortunately, Swift became blind while imprisoned, making him unable to find his treasure, leaving it buried forever.
He took a deep breath and sat up, pulling his shoulders ramrod straight.
Or until someone finds it.
Murmurs from the crowd around Mason came up as they dispersed to their own campfires, campers, or headed home. Abby Fawn, Queenie French, and Mary Elizabeth Moberly, my adoptive mother, all walked up. I glanced around them and noticed Mayor Courtney McKenzie had made her way over to Mason. Mayor McKenzie rarely came to the campground for monthly themed parties, and her presence made me question why she was there. Mayor McKenzie didn't do anything that didn't get her attention. An election year was right around the corner.
"Do you need any help cleaning before we go?"
Abby asked, breaking my concentration. "Nah." I blinked a couple of times to get present with my girlfriends.
"It'll give me something to do tomorrow," I said.
Every month, I hosted a get-together between the community and the camping tourists. It was a fun party, where Blue Ethel and the Adolescent Farm Boys, a local band, strummed on their instruments, giving it their best go at bluegrass music, while the guests enjoyed local foods donated by restaurants in Normal.
"That is a fun campfire story," I said to Abby Fawn, noticing all the camping lots and the campers I provided for rental were all occupied.
It was nice to see all the campfire rings lit up. I'm sure it's the talk around all the s'more making. I noticed everyone was enjoying the ingredients I'd given them when they rolled into the campground as a little special treat to thank them for choosing Happy Trails Campground for their vacation.
"Story?"
Abby swung her head toward me, flinging her ponytail around. She stared wordlessly at me.
"Oh, honey, it's no story."
Queenie French's hot pink jazzercise leotard shimmered more than the blanket of stars in the midnight sky. She picked at the edges of her short blonde hair nervously.
"Don't you know all of these people are here just for the annual Legend of John Swift excursion?" "You're pulling my leg."
Mary Elizabeth's southern-accented voice held questions.
"Right?"
She fingered the pearls around her neck.
"I ain't pulling nothing."
Queenie's nose curled. Her right brow rose.
"I'm telling you, there's several people out there who have found crown catches from John Swift's counterfeiting in these here caves."
Mary Elizabeth ran her hands down her Lily Pulitzer jumpsuit and then clasped them in front of her. "The library is filled with tourists trying to get their hands on one of John Swift's treasure maps." Abby shook her head.
"I keep telling them they need to go to the Historical Society."
Abby was the local librarian, Tupperware representative, and social media expert.
"Is that why I've had an uptake in calls?"
Queenie's face drew as she stepped to the side to get a good look at Abby. She put her hands on her hips.
"I was about to tell the mayor I was stepping down as the Historical Society president because it's taken up too much time away from my jazzercise classes."
Queenie French was in her 60s. She was active in the community and taught jazzercise in the undercroft of the Normal Baptist Church. I'd like to say she kept all the citizens of Normal in shape, but she only kept them in the latest gossip.
"From now on, I'm telling them to go back to the library."
Queenie crossed her arms in frustration.
"Or don't answer the phone."
Mary Elizabeth's face lit up like it did when she heard Nordstrom's was having their big annual sale.
"Abby, you don't need to worry about the library because,"
Mary Elizabeth bounced with excitement,
"we are going to go on the expedition."
"Did you get into Bobby Ray's moonshine?"
I asked, referring to my foster brother.
"Bobby Ray?"
I flailed my arms in the air and yelled over to him, where he was with a group of friends.
"Hush,"
Mary Elizabeth batted my arms out of the air.
"I'm serious. We haven't done anything exciting since I moved here.
She started to count on her fingers.
December, January. She continued reciting the months. 8 months I've been here and not been camping at all.
In those 8 months, you bought the milkery and opened a bed and breakfast. I'd say you've been very busy. I recalled the dairy farm and all the hard work she and Dawn Gentry had put into the milkery's old farmhouse to open a much-needed bed and breakfast in Normal. Besides, I have to run the campground. Abby has to work at the library. And Queenie, well, she'd never cancel her jazzercise classes.
Yes, I would.
Queenie nodded back and forth between me and Mary Elizabeth.
I could take some time off, too, Abby shrugged. I have some vacation time. What are we talking? Just the weekend?
Dottie said it's not real. A nervous laugh escaped me. I pushed a strand of my curly brown hair behind my ear. I had to stop this nonsense. I'd seen that look in Mary Elizabeth's eye before, and it was the kind that meant when she had her mind on something, nothing stood in her way to get it, whatever it was.
If you don't want to do it, then we will do it.
Mary Elizabeth's chin lifted in the air, and she looked down her nose at me.
Though I'd normally beg you to wear something presentable, you're going to have to wear different shoes.
I knew when I decided to wear the cute sequined flats that Mary Elizabeth would love them. They were from the Neiman Marcus from my former life. A few of the finer things I did keep, and I pulled them out every once in a while. Plus, I loved how they sparkled and glistened like the lightning bugs when I was standing near the campfire.
Oh, come on, May, Abby nudged me. It'll be fun. We can even drive your camper and stay in it instead of a tent.
Sounds wonderful.
Queenie did a grapevine dance move with excitement.
I'll be here in the morning.
She waved goodbye to us and headed to the parking lot in front of the campground.
This is perfect.
Mary Elizabeth squealed with delight, just like the time I'd agreed to enter the Miss Eastern Kentucky beauty pageant at the county fair when I was 16. That turned out to be a disaster, and I'd put money on it that this little treasure hunt would be too. The three of them had decided upon a time to meet in the morning. We all agreed I'd ask Mason if it was all right, so we could be sure he didn't mind four tag-alongs.
I'll text you what he says, I told them.
He can't stop us from going to look for the treasure.
Queenie was bound and determined to go on the hunt this weekend.
I'm the one they have to register with, so I'll just march on over to the Historical Society office in the morning and put our names on the list. You just let me know which campsite they are intending to use.
Campsite? I asked. I was still a little green to most things in the camping world.
You mean campground?
No, I'm talking primitive campsites. But you can put your RV on it. Just not all the fancy you got here.
She rolled her hand in front of her.
There are several campsites that cater to the treasure hunters just for the John Swift silver mine expeditions. Unfortunately, some of those roads are gravel and not stable for big recreation vehicles like your RV.
She glanced over her shoulder to Mason's camper behind his big truck.
He must be going somewhere that's not too terribly hard to get to, if he's taking that big thing.
Either way, if he is, we can still go somewhere else,
Abby smiled.
I have so many John Swift maps that I can get, it won't matter where we lay our heads at night.
I'm still in.
Mary Elizabeth rubbed her hands together. She looked like she was in, with her perfectly styled hair and beautiful red fingernails. I was sure she'd just gotten manicured by Helen Pyle down at Cuticles. However, I would be curious to see Mary Elizabeth without her pearls, which I've never done. I swore she slept in them.
Fine, y'all go on home, and I'll head on over to talk to Mason.
I shooed them off and made my way over to the mayor and Mason's inner circle.
Mighty fine party you hosted.
The mayor flashed her million-dollar pearly white smile that I knew had to come from some dentist not in Normal. It was one of the dye jobs only one of those sleep-in dental plates could give, or so claimed the infomercials. She had her long red hair pulled up in a high ponytail like a cheerleader,
Her long and lean frame wore a linen jumper with a pair of sensible sandals.
"Thank you. Mason, I see you met our mayor," I smiled, looking between them. "I'm so happy you're here."
"And miss a chance to talk to one of Normal's regular John Swift hunters? Never!" she gasped and drew her hand up to her chest, showing off the hand with no wedding ring.
She batted those big eyes. In the dark of the night, I could see Mason blush.
"He's going to find that treasure. And with his advice, I'm so pleased to let him know his suggestion of the asphalt was presented at the Kentucky Assembly, and I got it passed."
"You did?" Mason sounded a little shocked. "What asphalt?" This was the first I'd heard of any projects taking place locally.
"As a matter of fact, they started a couple of days ago."
She propped her hands on her hips in a bossy way.
"I told them the sooner the better."
"What asphalt?" I asked a little louder this time.
"Last year, the mayor had asked me what improvements she could make to the trails getting to the Swift mines, and I told her how we could stay longer, which does pour money into the community, if we had roads instead of gravel."
He stomped his foot in the gravel we were standing on. If he only knew how much asphalt cost to replace the gravel, he'd appreciate that we let him even look for the John Swift. But I kept my mouth shut.
"I took his suggestion to heart and realized how right he was, and saddened the treasure hadn't been found."
She gave me a squinch-eyed look, like I better not have any sort of opinion on what she was yammering on about.
"I went straight to Frankfurt for the assembly when it was in session with my concerns. And don't you know they have grants for such things as this?"
"As mayor, you didn't know that?" I just had a hard time keeping my mouth shut, but it was a very reasonable question.
"I have not only the Kentucky legislature and law to understand, May, but also the national parks laws and regulations that have to go together."
The mayor put her hands together like she was doing a puzzle with her fingers.
"And it just so happens they started on the gravel road to the furnace."
She raised her brows at me like I knew what the furnace was.
"That's exactly where me and my crew are headed."
Mason seemed very happy with the big news.
"Now, I did hear some rumblings from our local news reporter. There was some whispering about some protesting going on from one of the environmental groups about asphalt."
The mayor was quick to dismiss any sort of claims.
"So, just keep going tomorrow if anyone is protesting. I've got the police on alert."
I skimmed over her protest comment and decided to let Mason in on how me and my crew were going to join him.
"Mason, me and a few of my friends are going to join you if you don't mind."
I looked Mason in the eyes and tried to determine what kind of man he really was and if he would help us. One of Mason's crew members let out a loud sort of protest before he cleared his throat and looked down at his feet.
"Your friends?"
Mason looked up at me. "Just me and a few of my close friends who have lived here all their lives, minus Mary Elizabeth, but she'll probably stay in the RV the entire time, air conditioning and all." I waved my hand in front of my face.
"There's no electrical hookup at the campsite we're going to, so you probably wouldn't be comfortable if someone needs air."
He looked as if he had an out with me.
"You know, we are in the dog days of summer here." The mayor fanned her hand before her own face. "My mama never let me play in the creek during the dog days. Said it was bad luck. There are a lot of creeks near the furnace."
"What is the furnace?" I finally asked.
"It's a rock formation, believed to be in the area where some of the silver is hidden. And with the new asphalt roads, there's a greater chance someone will finally find the silver after 400 years.
The mayor was still selling the asphalt.
"You know, I think we'll be fine," I shrugged. "If not, we can leave."
"According to the Weather Channel, there seems to be a little rain moving in over the weekend, but nothing to worry about."
The mayor was saying anything to keep in the conversation. She seemed a little nervous.
"Maybe you and the gals should just hike your trails."
"I think we will be fine."
I gave the mayor a hard look.
"If you really want to go."
Mason gave in, but his friend stormed off.
We will be leaving from here around 8 a.m.
Perfect. We will be ready. Have a good night's sleep. I walked away before he could stop and think about us tagging along, not giving him any time to tell me he really didn't want us to go.
May! May!
The mayor hollered after me and trotted up next to me. I continued to walk.
Don't you mess this up for normal. You of all people know how important it is to continue with the great economy.
What are you talking about? I stopped and turned to look at her, a little confused.
Look at my campground. I obviously have the best in mind for normal.
You don't know, do you? She smiled.
You know it's just a legend. The silver. I mean, John Swift is real, but it's been 400 years. No one has found it?
She laughed. Then she stopped when she saw that I'd not joined her.
You really believe the legend, don't you?
I never heard of the legend until tonight, but Abby and Queenie seem to believe it. We're really just going for the fun of it, real or not. I shrugged.
I don't care really what you think, but I'm going to do whatever it takes for everyone in the world to believe somewhere deep in the Daniel Boone National Park, specifically Normal, that the John Swift silver mine is still buried and ready for all the treasure hunters of the world to come here and spend as much money as they want in our town to find it. Do you and I have an understanding?
She caught her eyes at me and started laughing when Mason walked by.
I hope you girls have a great time and good luck.
I stood there watching the mayor sashay off to another group of campers to tout how she'd gotten the government grant for the asphalt.
Some tale, right?
The woman I noticed had caught Mason's stare and almost threw him off his story stopped in front of me.
The John Swift legend,
she clarified when she noticed my confusion. Oh, that, I laughed. I had no idea. I've been here a while now and still don't know all the secrets the forest holds.
There's so many secrets.
She winked and headed off before I got to ask her name or question her any further.
Nice shoes, by the way.
Many more secrets? I stared at her since I was now more intrigued with the town I'd made my home. I clicked the heels of my shoes together and smiled.
There's no place like home. There's no place like home.
I laughed and headed in the opposite direction. 2.
I'm coming,
I hollered through my home on wheels from my bedroom, which was located in the far back. My new home was a far cry from the Manhattan skyrise or the beautiful beach house in the Hamptons. You might question how on earth did I end up in the camper.
Well, I'd say I wasn't the happiest person in the world when I found out my now dead ex-husband, Paul West, hence my last name, had pretty much screwed everyone we knew when he pulled one of the biggest Ponzi schemes that had ever taken place in the United States.
He left me with nothing but a rundown camper and campground, along with a lot of people who, well, let's just say had a very bad taste in their mouth about me.
I'm not going to lie. I'd planned on traveling to Kentucky, selling Happy Trails Campground along with the old camper,
and getting back to my life in New York. Mary Elizabeth always told me nothing ever turned out as planned.
Boy, was she right.
If you told me a year ago that I'd be living in a camper in the middle of the Daniel Boone National Forest in a campground that I owned and would have a dog and date a detective, I'd have laughed in your face. Turned out, I was in love with my life in Normal, and I'd embraced my Kentucky roots once again.
Again?
Yep. I grew up in Kentucky. I loved my life until my family was killed in a home fire and I was placed into foster care. Don't get me wrong, Mary Elizabeth Moberly's house was fine. It was all the manners and classes she insisted I take in order to be a Kentucky debutante that weren't so appealing. Now, if my mama had put me in those things, I probably would have loved them. But as a teenager, I didn't want no one but my mama. That included Mary Elizabeth. When the clock struck midnight on my 18th birthday, I was out of there. And that's how I got to New York, where I'd become a flight attendant, and met Paul West on a flight. "Hey," I swung open the door, putting my foot in front of the opening, so Fifi, my poodle, didn't run out when I let Detective Hank Sharp and Chester, his dog, into the camper. "No, Fifi." Fifi danced around in anticipation of Chester. She loved Hank's hunting dog, though Hank didn't hunt.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.